Two, action.
We'll run through a bit of a preamble. Minimum size for mackerel, 90 centimetres. A 90 centimetre mackerel, for those of you that haven't shot one, weighs about 3 kilos. I can vouch for that. That's about the only... Oh, and you're allowed 3 a day. You do need a fishing licence to spear them. And we'll start off with where do you find them? So, this is a bit of an amalgamation of reef, and seeing there's only a few of you here, it is also a little bit from Bernier and Dorrie Island up at Carnarvon. So when you're looking for mackerel, you're looking for current, where a current is being disturbed, and it'll happen at the end of a reef. It'll happen like when there's the gap in a reef where water's rushing in and out as the tide goes in or the tide goes out. But it'll also happen too where the reef protrudes. Anything that interrupts current flow, and I haven't put it on here, but this reef will run north-south. So anything that interrupts current flow, and not just on the point here, but also in here, you'll find there'll be quiet water in here. There'll also be, obviously, there's quiet water here too. And then in areas like this where there's quiet water, you'd be looking for mackerel all through there. So, yeah, you're looking, and the reason for that is the mackerel are looking for bait, and bait will come down with current, but you also need certain water temperature as well. If it's too cold, you're not going to get the bait coming down. So it's not current just on its own, but it's also water temperature. And the mackerel will be chasing the bait chasing the water temp. All right, the other place that you'll find them, mackerel, is on isolated lumps. So they can either be shallow lumps in deep water, like I have heard of a lump out of Kalbarri in about 48 metres of water, it only comes up 2 metres. And the pros reckon there's always mackerel hanging around it. So you can get like small lumps, deep water, if it's in isolated areas. If there's lots of reef and that around the place, there's no reason for bait to be there or for mackerel to be there. But these isolated lumps do seem to attract fish in general, mackerel in particular.
Come up to 48 metres?
No, the lump only comes up a couple metres in 48 metres of water. Yeah, which it's really stuck with me because it's an odd thing. It's sort of counterintuitive. You sort of think, you know, what's the reason for that? But perhaps some current is hitting that and it's pushing it up, and then with that, the bait gets pushed up as well. And that then sort of stalls the bait, and so the mackerel will hang near there.
Down at 48 or up near the top?
Oh, probably up near the top, but I have shot mackerel at 20 metres and deeper. We'll get into that, and there's an issue about shooting mackerel in deep water, which I'll get to at a later point. They also seem to like a large patch of sand, so this in some senses is like the reef at the Beagles, and you know, you've got this lump. This jetty here is actually a bit further down at the Beagles, and it doesn't have this gap, but I needed to draw this to highlight what features you're looking for when you're looking for mackerel ground. I'll go on to specific locations a bit later on. I just want to give you the theory of where to look for mackerel, so you can take this with you wherever you go around Australia. So you're looking for current, you're looking for points where the current is going to be disturbed or interrupted. And yeah, if this was just like one sausage of reef and there was one little bump there, you would dive that bump. You know, you would also dive the end up here. Doesn't mean that mackerel is going to be there, you might have to hunt around for them. And that's another issue too. Some people prefer to burly an anchor, others will hunt around. So they also seem to like a large patch of sand. So if you've got sand out the front here, that'll be really good mackerel country. They don't seem to like a lot of weed, or you do get random mackerel in weedy country, but they're randoms. And I'll go into randoms a bit later on if we've got time. What we're looking at here is where you're typically going to find mackerel, not in your like your weird or unusual or unexpected locations. Now, some places where you can find mackerel in the metro area, west end of Rottnest, north side of Rottnest as well, but the west end is a very good place, particularly I think it's the southwest corner of West End, the marine park there. There's a yellow marker buoy indicates the southwest corner. If you go north of that about 100 metres, starts having a look around there. This is a good example of mackerel seem to inhabit a certain area, and they'll do laps. And this is, I've seen this with tuna when I used to lure fish for bonito at North Mole. These mackerel will do a lap, and every half hour they'll come back. It doesn't matter if you're burling up 200 metres away, they will not go that extra 200 metres. it's almost as though, like, you've got to find that area where they're going to be chucking their laps, where they're going to be hanging around. So that's an important thing. The other place, in the back of 3 Mile, our 3 Mile goes from the Bovards all the way up to Jero. And in fact, yeah, that's probably about it. Yeah, so up to Geraldton. For those of you who don't know, 3 Mile is that sort of main line of reef that's up there. So out the back there is a good place to look for mackerel. And again, look for a distinguishing feature. Look for the end of a line of reef. Look for a reef that sticks out further. Look for, although I haven't highlighted it here, look for, see where the bottom is a bit deeper. So, you know, you might find at the bottom of the back of the reef, it's like 15, 15, 15. And then you get this section that's about 200 or 300 metres long, and it's 20 metres deep. Dive that area there. So look for points of difference and points that stand out. Because if everything looks the same, there's nothing to hold a fish's interest there. There's nothing to keep the bait there. So we've got the back of 3 Mile, and the depth will vary between 12 and 20 metres. The top of the reef will be zero down to 12 to 14 metres. And we've shot mackerel, you know, all the way along the back here, all the way up to Geraldton on the back of that 3 Mile. If you're new at it, it does pay to cover a bit of ground. Spearos don't do it, but line fishermen do. You anchor up on a spot or you drift a spot, you don't catch anything in the first 15 to 20 minutes, you move. And that's been my philosophy because I've come from a line fishing background. So if the place is not producing fish, just move. It doesn't matter how hard you swim, how much burley you chuck in the water, how many flashes you've got, how much noise you make. If the fish aren't there, they aren't there. It's as simple as that. Doesn't matter how great the ground looks, just move. Direction bank. That's a bit further out off the coast. It's sort of more or less in line with Rottnest. It goes south of Rotto down to Perenlumps. And then it keeps going up through the Abrolhos and then north of the Abrolhos by about 30 k's, I think it is, to Shallow Shoal. And that's about 30 k's offshore, though up at Shallow Shoal it's 80 k's offshore. And again, direction bank doesn't have a lot of features on it. And yes, you will get mackerel there, but then it's, if you can imagine, it's like a huge backbone which runs more or less parallel to the coast. What you're looking for there is to find a lump or a hole or some reason that bait or fish are going to hang around. Yes, you will get your randoms there. It's not a great place to get mackerel. You do have to put a lot of work in there. But there are obvious places like Turtle Dove always holds, well, it doesn't always hold mackerel, does hold mackerel most of the time. And Shallow Shoal always holds Spanish mackerel. And then the Abrolhos, which is also, you could sort of deem it as part of Direction Bank. Although it doesn't have the same, it's got a lot more coral there than what you see on the rest of Direction Bank. But it's in line with everything. So I just assume it's just an outgrowth of Direction Bank. So again, Direction Bank, the back of 3 Mile. And yeah, Direction Bank, Rottnest is part of Direction Bank in a way. The back edge of 5 Fathom. So we've had success in the last few years with diving 5 Fathom bank, particularly along the back edge there, where it's sort of 15 to 17 metres onto the sand, where the reef drops away. It drops away to 17, 18, 19, and then it comes up a little bit again for reef, but then it drops away to 24, 25. That area there seems to produce good mackerel. And I'm pretty sure you can get mackerel in between 5 Fathom and 3 Fathom bank. For those of you who don't know 3 Fathom, it's like Stragglers, the reef out the back of Garth and Karnak. There's a long sand channel there. You would get mackerel along there, I'm sure of it. We've just never bothered trying. So the back edge of 5 Fathom. And as you saw, some of you have seen today on Facebook, there's someone shot a mackerel down at Albany. But we can regularly shoot mackerel down at Yelling Up, Marga River, Quarum Up, that area there. Naturalist Reef, I heard a couple of weeks ago that someone had seen or they'd caught line-fished Spanish out at Naturalist Reef. And it does seem to be over the last 4 or 5 years that there's almost like a resident school down at Yelling Up. And you could probably... I did hear rumours of a school down at Augusta for a while there for a few years. I suspect that you'd be able to get fish down there this year. It does seem as though the water's got very hot very quickly. I mean, it's taken a while, but it certainly has come in pretty strongly now. And seeing that mackerel down in Albany, that's a good sign. That's a really good sign. That means there's a lot of warm water pushing down. Now, high tide or cooler months of the year, you'll find mackerel on top of the reef. Now, what they're doing there, I used to think it was they were chasing the warm water because I'd see them. You'd see big mackerel in the cooler months of the year on the top of the reef. But I've since read that they're also chasing bait fish, and that does make sense. with a rising tide, bait moves in. And mackerel will follow the bait, and again, so they'll be chasing them on top of the reef. So if you happen to be diving, say, like an incoming tide, and it's near the top of the tide, have a look on top of, say, this reef here. And you'll see mackerel. And I've seen enough, and I've heard of enough big fish being shot to know that's not just theory. You do see mackerel on the top of the reef. Although, generally what we would do is we would pick out a likely location, we'd swim it, we might throw a bit of burley in the water, but I'm not a big fan of burley, and I'll go into the pros and cons of burleying and the two other techniques that you can use. So we would dive, say, like that, look from there. If we can't find anything there, we might come out here and then dive this in here. And we might even swim along this section. If this is only like a kilometre long, we might even do the leapfrog dive. We'll chuck a couple of divers in here. The other two will anchor the boat. These guys swim to here. They'll go past the two divers and anchor the boat here and then dive that section there. So again, covering ground, looking for your mackerel. Some days it's really easy. Other days you seem to have to dive a lot of... Now, I've got next day written here. Now, next day refers to the fact that, say, you're doing a two-day trip on an island or at a reef, and you see this huge mackerel, and it's there, and you miss it. All right, there's a fair chance that if you go out there the next day, that mackerel will be out there again. So bear that in mind if you do see a really big mackerel, and you miss it on the first day. And as you see here, this is a map of Australia. The mackerel occur... I was going to say Augusta, but obviously for this year, it's Albany all the way around to, or who knows, they could end up in Victoria in the next 2 or 3 years. The way the East Australian current's going down the coast and pushing all those tuna down, and the water's warmer, I wouldn't be surprised if they start getting more pelagics down that way. In Perth, the mackerel season goes from November to July. In the best of years, it'll start in November. For quite a few years now, it started in December, and this year it sort of started in January, sort of. Even I don't think anyone's put up a fish or a mackerel that they've shot in Perth yet.
Was that Perth though?
Confirmed.
Let's not go into there. I don't want to sidetrack my talk. We could. You've got a season for mackerel. You're looking for this type of reef, and like I said to you, the various areas, west end of Roto, north side of Roto, the back of 3 Mile, direction bank, look for lumps. There's a hole 33 kilometres due west of the Two Rocks boat ramp. It used to hold good dewies. It probably still does occasionally, but you want to be out there as soon as they move in. That is also a good location for Spanish mackerel if you want to go out the direction bank. They do burley a lot out there, but we'll talk about burley. All right, So bear that in mind. So where these red X's are is where you're going to be looking for. Look for interrupted current flow. This is where you're looking for your typical mackerel, not your randoms. And there are randoms, and we'll go into randoms a bit later on.
And in terms of diving techniques, are we responding better to aspetto
or
what?
Aspetto,
when you go at the bottom
in
wave?
Yeah,
I'm going to
get into that now.
Okay. All right. Okay, so... Now we go into how to attract them. Okay, that's shooting. Save that one for later. For distract. So now that you've got the ground, you want to get close to your mackerel. We'll talk about burley versus flashes versus swimming and diving. And then there is a new technique which I've used in the last 12 months with some success and some little bit of concern. So we'll talk about burley first. So it's a combination of burleying and swimming. So with burley, you're in one spot, burley drifts one direction. It'll always drift down current if you've got current. So you're not going to attract any fish that are up current. Unless they happen to be cruising by. You're not going to attract any fish that are off to one side or the other side. So you really have to pick a spot which you know produces mackerel. You can't just, again, you cannot just anchor up and burley and expect to get a fish. It does come down to spot selection if you're going to do burley. So the advantages of it are, so that's the disadvantage. The advantages of it are that it's easy, you know, just shredding there all day, you know, like one person diving up and down. And you got to wait. You're close to the boat, So if you do happen to get a big fish, or you're you do get a shark in, which you will do. With burley, you will get sharks. You'll get good sized sharks. Even in Perth, you'll get 12 foot tiger sharks. You may even get a white. So yeah, that's the advantages and the disadvantages of burley. So the other technique, which I use a fair bit, is to swim and dive. So basically what that means is that I'll pick... So if we were going to burley up, you would pick this sort of node or jetty which sticks out here, and then you would anchor the boat, and ideally you would like the boat to hang out in the deeper water, and then your burley would drift down this way. And the theory is that the mackerel finds the burley and they swim up there and they get it. It's not just the burley that brings them in, it's also the it's not just the aroma, it's also the physical presence, so like bits of things floating down in the water. It's also fish snapping at the burley, little fish feeding at it. And it also, it probably even is something as minute as fish swimming. You might find that, I don't know how you guys go, but I don't actually pick fish by the way that they look. I pick fish by the way that they swim. Now, if a fish is just swimming around lazily, and then suddenly it sees some food or potential food, it changes its swimming action. And that swimming action will actually produce vibrations in the water. And I'm pretty sure that other fish pick up on that. So you'll get that happening. So they're the advantages of burley. But like I said to you, goes only in one direction. You're sort of hoping that mackerel will swim this way. The mackerel from here will not go across to there unless they hear the, you know, like there's like savage chomping of gnashing of teeth from chewing on the burley or crunching of the bone from the burley. And you've always got the ever presence of sharks. Now, the other technique, which is the one that I tend to favour, is to swim and dive. So what I'll do is maybe jump in here, and I might actually, sometimes it's actually worthwhile coming away from the reef, particularly like somewhere like the Beagles, and you'll be perhaps, you know, up to half a kilometre out the back in, say, 23, 25 metres of water, just on clean sand. And this is your point about diving down. If the mackerel are not there against the reef, sometimes it pays to go out in the sand and just dive down the bottom and just wait. And that'll bring mackerel in. Now, this brings me to a point which you need to be aware of if you're using a reel gun. You shoot a mackerel in 20 or 25 metres of water, you're going to probably get spooled before you get back to the surface. Right? Which means you're probably going to have to let go of your gun, unless you've got a massive breath hold or it's a small mackerel. So bear that in mind when you shoot a mackerel at that depth. When you're standing on the bottom, this thing swims past. Because these mackerel don't head for the surface. They head horizontal once you spear them. I've been spooled by a mackerel that I was only 12 metres down. I was spooled before I got halfway back to the surface. And there are other times I have shot mackerel at 20 metres. I haven't been spooled, but I've been close. So do bear this in mind. If you're going to use a reel gun and you're going to start shooting big fish or big pelagics in deep water, that you may end up having to drop your gun. So you can either use a belt reel or you clip your gun off to a float line. So you would swim out here, perhaps hug the bottom, you'd come along here, and again, every minute that you swim, you do a dive. And normally I'll do like a minute swim, minute dive, minute swim, minute dive. Just the action of you diving up and down will bring mackerel in. You don't have to use any burley. I'm sort of thinking like, I don't even drag a flash around because a flasher tends to slow me down. So we'll cover quite a lot of ground. So that's that. The disadvantages of that is, because you've only got a reel gun, you don't have a float and a float line, it's very hard for your buddies to spot you. So do bear that in mind if you are going to go for the swim and dive. It pays to drag a float around. At the very least, have a big safety sausage that you can inflate and wave around like crazy, hoping that they'll see you. You can end up a long way from the boat. It does require a bit of fitness, and it does require you to be consistent with your diving up and down. It's almost, the way I look at it is like, I'm actually setting up dots of sound. I know this might sound weird, but, so every time I dive and then come back again, you know, like a little bit of fish activity is created. And I'm sure that fish from quite a distance away can pick this up, and Sound, unlike burley, travels in 360 degrees. And this is the advantage of swimming and diving and creating noise over just burley and noise. Well, yeah, well, you're probably making noise there, but at least you're swimming and you're covering ground. And then, so what I, in my mind, and I don't know if this is true or not, is I visualise the fish joining the dots and eventually coming onto me, and they'll find me that way. And this all comes down to like making noise in the water, regular diving, diving on ground where it looks fishy. So I'll be swimming along, and I might see like a little banded sweep, or I might see a few wrasses just milling about somewhere. I'm like, wow, that's different. And I'll dive down there, and that'll get their interest, and they'll come up at me and have a look at me, da 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 da. And then who knows, there might even be a dewey there or a coral trout or something like that. But this noise, I think, is quite a crucial factor in attracting mackerel. And a lot of times you'll find, you'll see the mackerel on the way back up from a deep dive. And you'll, and because you've come up from the bottom, the mackerel tend to be a lot friendlier. They'll come within 2 or 3 metres of you, these big fish. Whereas if you dive on the same fish from the surface, more than likely, it will spook, it'll swim away, and then it'll slowly arc its way back to you. And that will require you to hold your breath and to look away and to look away. And it might take another minute for it to relax. So this is the swim and the dive. Now, the other thing which I've introduced, and in last year's Glendromy, I managed to shoot a mackerel this way, was to swim and burley. So what you do here is you shoot a little... shoot a small fish, shoot a small buffy, banded sweep, and then what you want to do is eviscerate it. So you're trying to set up a little curtain of eviscerated fish meal to start a scent, like a trail. And then you keep swimming and you eviscerate and you eviscerate, you just sort of shred this fish. Every now and then you might cut off a big chunk, still do your diving. My theory is this will that a fish will come across this trail and follow this trail to you. The only downside with this, which I mentioned earlier, was last year when me and Hides were diving. It's the first time I've ever seen a 12-foot tiger shark in the metro area. And it came up so close that Hyde had to tickle it with a spear. So that is the disadvantage of swimming and burleying. And we were miles from the boat, so you know, look, we had another 7-footer come in. And eventually I thought, no, this is too hard. So we used up all the burley, and once all the burley was gone, the tiger sharks left us alone. But it is a point to bear in mind, if you're going to swim and burley, is that yes, it will attract pelagics, yes, it will attract sharks. And unlike when you're burley near the boat, you have no boat to jump back into. So it probably pays to do the swimming and the burleying with a buddy. All right, so any questions about... I just touched on it briefly about a mackerel... Oh, that's swimming and burleying, all right. So now we've got... you've got two options with gear. So I think I touched on those. Use a reel gun or a float line, or a combination of both. Sometimes I'll actually clip a float line to the reel gun, particularly if I think there's a chance of shooting a really big fish. So the next thing is you'll be swimming along. Say you're swimming down this reef, or you're swimming through, and you come past this opening, and you see this log just cruise underneath you. And what do you do? Do you dive straight on it? Do you dive away from it? Ideally, do not get excited. You want to dive off to one side, dive slowly, dive quietly. Sometimes the mackerel are jumping, sometimes they're not. But either way, dive to one side. If you can get a shot in it, shoot it. Don't finesse it. These big mackerel may not come back. Sometimes they will. If you dive down to about 8 or 10 meters, wherever you're neutrally buoyant, and just hang there. And if you see the mackerel turn, and even though it's say 10 or 15 meters away, depending on what your vis is, then as the mackerel turns, you turn away. And as the mackerel keeps swimming in this direction, you also want to be turning away. And by the third turn, the mackerel will have reduced the distance between you and itself. And that's the time when you come back, and now the mackerel is swimming in this sort of arc. Hold your gun there, and when it swims past, shoot it that way. So this is a way of getting a mackerel closer. It does require a bit of breath hold. It's also a way of dealing with a mackerel that, as I said earlier, that spooks, that just shoots away, and then it might turn back. And then if you wait and look away, for some reason the mackerel are attracted to that look away. Look.
How many turns do they make?
I usually do two. I don't even let them get...
You're not talking about 360 degree. You're
just no, I'm just a little turn like this, and then a little turn like this, and then there, and then I'll look back and I go, yeah, there it is. It's coming here, it comes here. And out of the corner of my eye, I'll be seeing it. And then as it gets there, then I get the fish. And basically you have the gun. When the fish is coming past the gun, then you pull the trigger. But I'll go into shooting of the fish later on, because there are ways to improve your success with that. So look away. And I mentioned about diving deep does bring mackerel in as well. I've shot quite a few big mackerel from doing deep dives and coming up off the bottom, and to come up slowly, slowly, slowly and have a look around. Mind you, I've done a lot of deep dives for a few mackerel, but it seems to be more than just coincidence that they seem to get friendliest. And I've shot mackerel from underneath. They've come over the top of me and I've just basically shot them from underneath. Do bear in mind, dive within your limits here. So it's not the only way to get mackerel. It is one technique of getting mackerel. Like I said to you before, noise does bring mackerel in. Normally when I'm anchoring out the boat, I'll do donuts or figure eights, a couple of those, and then the rattle of the chain, drop it down. Bit of noise to bring mackerel in. It also brings sharks in too. It brings everything in. All right? But other things you can do when you're swimming around, the slapping of the fins, tapping of the gun on the weight belt, like with the handle on the weight of your belt. Some guys use a knife and they'll tap the handle on the barrel, although these days with carbon barrels, I don't know how well that works. And the other one which works really well, funny enough, is dry reaching. Dry reaching. You know, when you vomit, yeah, and you've got nothing to bring up, yeah, and you make this sort of guttural noise, that, for some reason, that brings mackerel in as well. So... it's like a burp underwater.
You're spending way too much time.
Yeah,
I've tried
a lot of techniques to get there.
Yeah, but making noise, and that's a way of making just a guttural noise underwater.
Especially if you do it when you're actually on the bottom. I love it.
Yeah. I found it out by mistake one day. Well, it was a mistake. All right, so that's finding the ground, how to get close to your mackerel. Now we'll go into probably the most important part, because this is the part where there's the most pressure. So I don't know if you can all see that there. So this is your mackerel. All right. This red line here represents a spear. Now this spear, although it looks perpendicular, I actually tried to make it at 45 degrees. When you shoot a Spanish mackerel, you want to shoot it... well, this is the way I'd recommend that you shoot, is on one side of the gill slit at 45 degree angle, so the spear comes out in front of the gill slit on the other side of the fish. Now, there's a few reasons for this. One, you've got a lot of vital organs here. So you've got the heart here, you've got major arteries. You've also got spinal cord. On the one hand, you can hurt a fish, and hurting a big mackerel helps a lot. It means you're not going to get towed around for ages. And you know, the other thing, if you do get towed, either keep your head well and truly out of the water, or dip your head down, because your mask will get pulled off. Like, all you'll see is foam. So the 45 degree shot, one, it's a good hurting shot. You want to hurt these big fish. You know, you want to hit the spine, or at least nick the spine. Secondly, because it's at 45 degrees, there's less chance of the shaft bending. And like I said to you before, with the mackerel, trying to get it close, don't wait till the fish is perpendicular to you to shoot it, because that means that the shaft is perpendicular. You actually want the mackerel to be past you and to shoot it at 45 degrees. This is in an ideal world. Sometimes any shot is better than no shot. All right? Third reason for shooting at 45 versus 90 is you've got more flesh that the spear is hanging into. So at 90, the fish is, say for example, it's 20 centimetres wide. At 45, it's probably 25 centimetres of flesh that the spear's gone into. There's less pressure on the shaft, so you don't flog the hole out that the shaft has created by going through the fish. And yes, I have lost mackerel to holes getting flogged.